Okay, very good morning to all of you, and welcome to the fifth day of this workshop. If you look at the schedule for the morning sessions, we are mostly going to deal with complex friction, and basically, as we have considered during the coordinator workshop, we are going to look into belt friction as well as square threaded screws, that is screw jacks more or less. So just to start off with, as you have seen that friction, we are approximating the solution on the basis of Coulomb friction or dry friction. We also sometimes call that point friction. Again, that's a very rough assumption, and as we all know that friction will depend on the tribology between the contacting surfaces. But more or less what we have studied, that if you for the time being just consider the point friction, then the analysis could be very simple. Only thing that we have to careful is with the direction of the friction force, how it is going to act. That's the first one. Secondly, as we have all seen, that when we try to look at problem involving impending motion, that means most of the problem that we look at without slippage problem, that means what is the, for example, if we look at a problem that I am trying to really push a body up on an incline, then my question would be, let's say, what is the load required, right, to just push the block up on the incline without slippage. So I am really therefore trying to enforce the condition of impending motion, and what it does basically, it does one thing that you have noticed, that it makes the number of unknowns equals to number of conditions that are required to solve the problem. So remember the friction law, therefore, that actually tells me or allows me to solve the problem in a statically determinate way. So therefore, when we have multi-body interaction, if we have looked at it carefully, we have said that in a multi-body interaction problem, let's say we have two contact surfaces may participate. In that case, what was the main principle that we have used? First, we try to identify the number of unknowns. So we have identified the number of unknown forces, right? Then we have limited number of equilibrium equations, right? So we have always seen that number of unknowns exceed the number of equilibrium equations, and therefore the balance unknown, okay? So that is the total number of unknowns minus the number of equilibrium equation, that's my balance unknown. And what we do is basically, if the problem is self-consistent, we are going to say that I should have that many contact surfaces where I would induce the friction loss. So it is as simple as that in word. However, remember, we are always enforcing a problem which is statically determinate in nature. And you have seen this from the very beginning, that no matter what topic I choose, my problem is always statically determinate. Otherwise, what happens in the process, that if the number of forces exceed the number of equations, then we need to invoke the deflection, that means kinematics as well, deformation of the body as well, to solve for the additional unknown forces. With that, what I will now try to look at some of the complex friction. Now, why do I call it complex friction? Remember, as you see in case of a belt friction, what is happening, I have illustrated few different examples here. For example, here you have a rope, right, that is passing over a bollard. What is the objective? The person can actually apply a very small amount of force to hold a very large load. You can see this very often if you go to jetties for anchoring of boats, for anchoring of ships and so on and so forth. You can see that by applying a small force, I can hold a large amount of load. Similarly, now what is happening that there is a large area of contact coming into play. However, remember, friction force is distributed between the rope and the surface. However, we are going to introduce the fact that we can still say that each and every point on the contacting surface should have simple friction law, that means Coulomb friction, and we are going to derive the relationship between the tension on the both sides based on that. So ultimately, if there is no friction, for example, between the pulley and the rope, then we say the tension in the both sides are same, which is perfectly fine. But when the friction exists, then we should understand that the force, that is the tension in one side of the belt, will differ on the other side. So again, this problem will help us to, you know, study applications that involve raising or lowering the loads. One thing that instantly comes to our mind is as follows. I would always require small force to hold a load. Suppose I put a 20 kg block here, I would probably need 5 kg to just hold the block. Two conditions are coming into play. In one case, in the first case, the block is trying to go down, that is impending motion is downward. So we are trying to invoke the impending motion condition when it is simply trying to go down. And we are trying to find out what is the load required to hold this body right here. Similarly, in the second case, if I consider the impending motion upward, right, then what will happen? I have to apply a large amount of load. And that is all possible because remember the friction direction is always being changed here. It is being reversed as you look at the problem involving loading, you know, holding the load, or the problem involving just raising the load. Okay? So friction will change the direction and tension side will always be on a side that will try to oppose the friction force, the larger tension side. Okay? So, another application as you see here, that is, you know, we see in the transmission of torque problem, right? So, you have somewhere a motor, that motor may be connected to some machine tool. So, we have again pulley or drum and belt problem. Okay. Remember, this problem, however, we will be tackling based on the fact that both are rotating at a constant speed. If both rotates at a constant speed, then we will try to understand that when the belt is trying to slip over the drum, what relationship exists between the tensions of these two. We should first try to understand also that where the slip would happen first. Whether it is going to be in the motor or whether it is going to be on the machine tool that is connected, right, that is being driven by the motor. The other example will be the band break problem. So you can see a disc and you have the, you know, band that is on top of the disc. Now you need some special arrangement here. There may be a connected to a lever arm where we are going to apply a force. So once you apply the force, this band is actually going to tighten on the disc and it will, you know, reduce the speed of this disc. So again, our idea would be that can I find the force required such that a constant velocity is maintained here. Okay. So, depending on the amount of force, you can actually control the speed of the disc that is rotating. Remember, here band is fixed on top of the disc, or in other words, there is a constant slippage between the disc and the belt or the band. Okay. Therefore, this will actually involve kinetic coefficient of friction than that of static coefficient friction. So, whenever we see that we have relative motion exist between the two contacting surfaces, then we are going to say that we have to induce kinetic coefficient of friction. So, let us try to just look at how do I derive the theory involving the belt friction problem. So, what is the question here? The question is relate T1 and T2. As you see, the T1 and T2 are the two tensions on the both sides. Relate T1 and T2 when belt is about to slide to the right. That means I am invoking the impending motion condition towards the right. So, if the belt is just about to slide over this drum or let us say disc towards the right, then which should be the direction of the friction? The friction will oppose the motion of the belt, therefore, friction will be on the opposite direction, and we can clearly see therefore, that T2 tension on this side has to be greater than tension on this side. Clear? Now, remember, as I said, that there is a contact angle beta that plays an enormous role. So, therefore, we can easily get a feeling that whatever formula I derive, T2 by T2 T1 relationship, that will be completely controlled by this angle beta as well as the coefficient of friction between the belt and the drum. So, now how do I get into the theoretical part? So, again, as I said, it is a complex friction because friction is actually applied throughout. Okay. Now, what we are going to enforce, I am going to simply take a very small segment of the belt and I am going to apply the concept of point friction or simple friction there, and I would assume that is everywhere. And finally, I have to get an integrated effect from P2 to P1. So, that is the basic concept. Therefore, let us just detach a segment PP prime. Suppose I detach a segment PP prime of the belt and I try to understand in this differential element that I have chosen PP prime, what are the forces that have been induced. Since as I said the T2 has to be greater than T1, so I can see here that here I have T plus delta T. Okay? And here you have only T. And from the geometry, we also understand that this angle is delta theta, therefore, this is delta theta over 2, delta theta over 2. Now, here is the important part. The important point here is that I should have a normal force delta n that is given by the drum to the belt. I should have a friction force delta f. Now, when the impending motion prevails, then we say that delta f equals to mu s delta n, that is our friction law. Now, therefore, you can see clearly that I have two unknowns in this problem. One is the delta t and delta n, right. So, t and n, these will be more or less my unknowns. So, therefore, now I will treat this body as a particle and I will try to understand that what is sum of force along x direction 0 and sum of force along y direction 0. So, if we do sum of force along x direction 0, we see that t plus delta t cosine delta theta by 2 negative t minus cosine delta theta by 2 negative mu s delta n 0. That is one equilibrium equation. And second equilibrium equation can always be written like this. Now, we have to find out, now I am only interested in finding out what relationship exists between T, mu and beta, let us say. Okay? So, my objective here would be to somehow eliminate delta n. Therefore, what I will do, I will simply take this equation. Remember, in this equation, this term and this term gets cancelled. So, delta n is delta t sin delta theta by 2, which I will simply substitute back here. Okay? And therefore, I am going to get this equation. Now, this equation, remember, I have also divided everything by delta a, delta theta, because delta theta cannot be 0. Okay? So, now what happens? As you see, the now the equation has been revised. I have one equation to play with, and that equation becomes this. Okay? Now, in the limit, as delta theta goes to 0, what happens? Remember, these terms will become 1. Delta theta goes to 0, tend to 0. So, this is 0, that is 1. What else happens? When really delta theta tends to 0, we can also say that delta theta, this one, delta t, right, that is also tends to 0. Okay? So, therefore, what I eventually get? I eventually get a very simple equation which looks like dt by d theta equals to negative mu s t. That is equals to 0. Okay? Now, remember that we have to separate, we have to use the separation of variables. So, we have dt by t must be equals to mu s d theta. So, once I use separation of variables, dt by t equals to mu s d theta, and I will integrate both sides. So, one side will go from t1 to t2, other side I will have 0 to beta. So, theta should go from 0 to beta, and t should grow from t1 to t2. So, these are the two integration limit that I am going to use after separation of variables. Okay? So, and that will lead to this, because dt by t, that is simply log of t, right? So, therefore, we have log t2 by t1 equals to mu s beta, because 0 to theta, that integral will become beta. So, ultimately, what is the relationship? T2 by t1 equals to e to the power mu s beta. So, therefore, what we have obtained, that during the impending sleep, when the belt is just about to slide over the drum, I have this relationship, T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta. Remember, there is no unique relationship that exists between, we can't find both T2 and T1 from just one equation. So, what it tells me, that I have a ratio, that ratio is controlled by e to the power mu s beta, where mu s is the static coefficient of friction and beta is the contact angle, that should be measured in radian. So, therefore, to avoid the impending slip, what formula shall I use? T2 by T1 should be less than e to the power mu s beta. If there is no slip between the or before the impending slip, I should always use T2 by T1 less than e to the power mu s beta. And if there is an actual slip, if there is an actual slip, that means there is a relative motion between the belt and the drum, I should use T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu k beta. So, if there is a relative motion that exists, then I should use e to the power mu k beta. So, therefore, again, if we have to summarize, we can summarize like this, that when the belt is about to slide towards the right during that impending motion, T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta. So, it is completely controlled by the coefficient of static friction and the contact angle, which is measured in radian. We should first understand that T2 has to be greater than T1 if the belt is about to slide on this direction, because all the friction forces will try to oppose that motion. Okay? And remember that if there is no slip, then T2 by T1 has to be less than e to the power mu s beta. If there is an actual slip, that means there is a relative slip between the belt and the drum, then T2 by T1 should be equals to e to the power mu k beta. Therefore, I can actually, you know, take this problem to solve a large class of, you know, application we can consider using this concept. What are those problems? As I said, the formula can be applied for impending slip condition for problems involving, those are the applications I have shown in the beginning, that flat belt passing over a fixed cylindrical drum. Okay, so that means your drum is fixed and belt is passing over that drum. Let's say you are trying to lower a object, you know, or you are trying to raise a object, or you are trying to lower an object. So in those kind of problems, it is going to come into play. Similarly, ropes, bells, you know, around a post or capstan or pulleys, we have gone through that also, and bell drive. So this is going to be very important. Remember, bell drives problem, we have both the drum and the belt, they rotate together at a constant velocity. So the question will be, when there will be a slip between the drum and the belt. So now, when it involves the motion problem, that means when it is rotating at a very fast speed, you can take one thing, you could ask me that, okay, is there a centrifugal force? So did I consider that in that equation? So therefore, now you can see the only thing is that we are always trying to understand here, the main assumption is belt is always in contact with the drum. It should not try to, you know, just separate away from the drum. So in other words, if the speed is really large, we may have to include the rho omega square r effect in this formula. However, as long as the mass of this belt remains small, we can actually ignore that term as well. So remember, in engineering mechanics problem, we are always trying to approximate the actual problem, and we are trying to get an answer which is as close as that of the actual solution. So we can always have this plus minus 10% error, as we say, okay, in as a thumb rule in any of these problems. Is that clear now? So now we are going to take few problems. So a cord is wrapped twice around a capstan at A and three times around second capstan at B. Finally, cord goes over a half barrel section. So that's the half barrel section and supports a mass M of 500 kg. Okay. Now the question is, what is the tension T required to maintain this load? Now only thing is that what is being asked, what is the tension T required to maintain this load? Or what is, you can also ask, what is the range of values of T for which equilibrium is maintained? Okay. Now, to study this problem, we should understand that there are two scenarios possible. What are these two scenarios? One is the upward impending motion of mass. That means we are actually trying to lift the mass up. Therefore, I have to first understand that T must be greater than the weight of the body here. The final T that you get should be greater than the weight of the body here. So this will be always your large tension side. Okay. So now, to get the minimum value of tension, that means we are simply trying to hold the load. That means load is trying to come down now. Okay. So in that case, my impending motion of the mass will be downward. Therefore, we can say that in this case, the tension in this side will be greater than the tension that you need here. So, that means Mg has to be greater than that of T. So, remember now, how do you understand the problem in terms of the force concept? Whether do I have a statically determinate problem or not? That is the first key. Remember, here the assumption was always that the belt, that is the rope, is always going to be a rigid body. Okay. Now, we try to understand this like this way, that if I have a tension here, my tension will be different here. Then I have another tension here, I have another tension here. So, how many problems, how many unknowns I have? The number of unknowns I have, 1, 2, 3. That means tension here, here and here. Remember, tension here is already known because that is simply going to be the weight. So, therefore, I have to repeatedly invoke the friction laws 3 times. My friction law now becomes T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta. So, I will apply that repeatedly between this tension, tension on the left side of the capstan A with the tension in the right hand side of the capstan A. Similarly, left side of the capstan B with the right side of the capstan B and left side of the barrel with the right side of the barrel. Okay. So, I have to really derive these 3 equations in order to get the ultimate tension that is required. So, as such it looks very simple to us now. So, what we are going to do? Firstly, remember that we must find out what is the angle of contact. As we have seen that rope here, the rope is wrapped twice here, right? So, the angle of contact will be 4 pi. Here, rope is wrapped 3 times. So, the angle of contact will be 6 pi. Okay? And what is the angle of contact in the barrel? It is simply pi over 2. So, first we understand what are the angle of contacts of the belt with the respective objects. Now, we try to draw the free body diagram. As I have told that you can see, I am interested really to find out what is T here. Right. So, T1 and T, so I have one unknown, the tension here, this is 2, second unknown, third unknown is T2. Okay. So, I have 3 unknowns in this problem and I am going to solve it. So, how do I solve it now? First, assume that impending downward motion of the mass. So, that means you are simply trying to hold this mass, the mass can try to go down. So, we are simply trying to hold this mass by applying the tension T. So, therefore, we can use this relationship one at a time. So, in this case, therefore, what is happening? This tension has to be greater than this tension. So, Mg by T2 should be e to the power mu s multiplied by beta of the barrel or the pulley. Okay. So, ultimately what you have, this tension is greater than this tension. Okay. So, this will now in the formula becomes T2 and this is actually T1. So, Mg by T2. Then this tension has to be greater than this tension. So, here T2 by T1. So, this is higher tension side. So, T2 by T1 is equals to e to the power again mu s. And beta, what is the beta? Beta is 6 pi because the rope is wrapped around 3 times. Similarly, this T1 must be greater than the T. So, we will use this one. Then only thing I had to do basically multiply all of this so that I get a relationship between mass and the tension that I am trying to find out. So, the final tension will be this. So, if I do this problem by saying now I am trying to pull the object up, okay, that means now I have to understand that impending down upward motion of M. That means now friction force will change the direction. So, now friction force will all be, you can tell like in clockwise in this case, okay. So, therefore, I can clearly tell that this side will have lower tension than this side. So, now this side is always going to have higher tension. So, now I have to just rearrange all of this. So, as I said, the above relation should be reciprocated. So, here we already have relationship T equals to mg to the power negative the total this thing 1.05 pi. So, we will just reciprocate this relationship. Why? Because now I have T greater than mg. Okay. Now, on other words, you can actually flip all of these equations. Just flip all of these, reverse all of these equations, same answer, same result. So, what is happening now since we have reversed it? So, you are going to get very large value of the T. You can see that it is so high compared to when you are just simply trying to hold the load. You are simply trying to hold the, you know, mass such that it does not go down. But when you are trying to raise the load, right, when I am trying to raise the load upward, then I need a very large amount of tension in the rope. Okay? So, is there any question so far? So, if this concept is clear, then we can go ahead. Any discussion on this issue? Short discussions?
Hello.
117. Yeah, go ahead, ma'am.
Sir, actually I wanted to ask about the coefficient of static friction and coefficient of kinetic friction. There is a general notion that the coefficient of kinetic friction is greater than the static friction. So, are there any conditions where we can get the both the coefficients equal or the static coefficient of static friction is greater than the kinetic friction?
No, no, there is no as such rule actually. See, that is not always true actually. The what you are saying that kinetic coefficient of friction is greater than static coefficient friction, I doubt actually that is always hold goods. Okay. So, that we need to, you need to clarify that first, okay. That may not be hold true first of all. So, secondly, see why this static coefficient of friction and kinetic coefficient of friction? In one case, there is no relative slip between the surfaces, right, that is participating. When we say static coefficient of friction, there is no actual relative slip. But kinetic coefficient of friction, when there is actual slip.
Okay. Sir, there is one more question from today's lecture. So, what is the difference between V-belt and flat belt friction coefficient?
Okay. So, okay, now your question relates to, that's a very natural question comes into mind, that what is the difference between a V-belt and the flat belt, right? Now, I will try to, you know, everyone understood the question. The question was a flat belt and a V-belt. Now, V-belt will only, you know, introduce one more, you know, unknown to the solution, so one more force to the solution rather to solve the problem, okay. Now, how that will happen? So, remember, I have to now draw it, okay. So, in the V-belt, so first, let us say when we are discussing flat belt, in flat belt, now you are really looking at the cross section of the belt. Okay. Now, in the flat belt case, if you look at, let us say, cross section and try to look at from this side, the cross section is rectangular in shape, right? Okay. Now, in case of a V belt, now where that is applied, if you look at the the cross section of it, so the cross section will look at so it is on a groove actually. The belt will now be on a groove, and this is the cross section. Okay. Now, what happens due to that? Let us say I have an angle V here, because it is a V shaped, right? That angle first I have to define. So, that angle, let us say alpha. So, what will happen? There will be additional reaction that is coming into play. Let us say delta R from this side and this side, okay, right? So, what will happen now? This has a resultant, these two, if you take the equilibrium, you can show like this. So, ultimately, what is happening? You have delta R, 2 delta R, isn't that? So, what happens? Now, we discussed this problem, na? So, now now you go back to your flat belt case. So, where we have looked at only this. Now, here I had a perfect delta n, right? I have T1, I had T2, this will be T plus delta T, that is the differential element I am choosing. So, basically that effect will come into play. So, this is T plus delta T. Now, in addition to that, what is happening? This force will come into play, which is given by the cross section. If you look at this, which is given by the groove onto the belt, and that will come in your perpendicular equation of equilibrium. Okay, so in addition to that, I am also going to get another force that is coming from the V belt. Clear? So, problem can be solved still, but we are not going to take that for the time being. But is that concept clear, that how this force is coming into the free body? And it can be solved. Okay. So, you will just going to get another additional alpha in the equation. So, therefore, this alpha will come now into the equation. Okay, it will come, I think, in terms of sin alpha. All right. Any other discussions?
Sir, is there a difference between the friction coefficient of V belt and flat belt?
See, coefficient of friction is determined by the two contacting surfaces, right? It all depends on, there is nothing, your question is there a difference between the coefficient of friction of flat belt and V belt? The answer is no, coefficient of friction is not, but what usually is written in the book is as follows. See, as I said, in the equation, I cannot really recall the equation correctly, but for V belt, I think it is something sin alpha by 2 that comes into play. Okay. Now, what we tend to say that this multiplied by the this. So, basically mu s sin alpha by 2, that is for the mu s, you know, of the V belt. I think that is what you are trying to ask. Is there a change in the coefficient of friction between the flat belt and V belt?
Yes.
My general answer is there is nothing change in coefficient of friction, but it is how you are writing it. So, basically I am now saying mu s sin alpha, that becomes the effective coefficient of friction in the V belt. Okay, clear?
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah, go ahead, sir.
Yeah.
In linear motion, we consider F is equal to m into a, but in rotation, we consider tau is equal to moment of inertia into alpha. Just a few days before, we have taught that moment of inertia is a type of resistance, but in linear motion, we consider mass is a type of resistance.
So now you are going to a completely different aspect. Remember, so your question is how the inertia comes into play. Your question is mass times acceleration and I times alpha. Answer is very simple. I said I am taking only problems involving constant velocity. Okay, even if my drum and the belt are rotating, they are rotating at the same angular speed. Okay, so when it's a constant velocity problem, then again you can go back to Newton's first law. So therefore, you can again use static equilibrium equation. So I am not taking any problem that will involve dynamic, but think this way, just simple experimental demonstration. Okay, I am rotating a disc is being rotated, so I apply some couple, right, to rotate the disc. I ask someone, just put a belt on top of that to decelerate the motion. What happens? How do I solve that equation of motion? So now what it comes, now the belt that you are really trying to decelerate the system, belt you are holding tightly, right, to decelerate the system, and therefore now the angular acceleration, right, that will become a decelerating body. Now if you take equilibrium of that, there you are going to see I alpha. So I alpha, that is going to come into play, and then you have T2 minus T1 multiplied by the distance, that's the torque. So that torque is actually going to equals to I times alpha. Now you are coming to moment equals to I times alpha. So now you solve for that alpha. Is that clear? Okay, so problem is very simple, whether it you are solving a dynamic problem or whether you are solving a static problem. Remember, constant motion problem is itself is a static problem. You can actually define it as a static problem. Okay,
sir, F is equal to m into a, it means Newton's formula is valid only for inertial frame of reference, but we considered in rotational, but in rotational there is a dynamic, then the dynamic in nature, then how can I apply Newton's formula?
What is here missing? Why cannot you see, if you are in a non inertial frame, then you will simply use the D'Alembert's principle, and that I am going to discuss when we talk about it. In non inertial frame means, that means you are actually inside that rotating, you know, you are actually inside that moving body. Then what happens? Your resultant force still becomes zero. Okay, but in an inertial frame, how you write it? You write force equals to mass times acceleration. But in a non-inertial frame, you will write force negative mass times acceleration equals to zero. That means there is no relative motion again if you are in a non-inertial frame. Okay.
Thanks, sir.
1145. Go ahead for your question.
Is there any friction between the center screw of the pulley?
In the with respect to what?
Sir, in the center of the pulley, there is a screw, no? Is there any friction between that screw and the pulley?
Good question, actually. Yes. So your question is there any friction between the screw or the hinge rather, right? Hinge and the pulley. What we have done so far, yes, no. We have not taken that into account. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So we'll see that in journal bearing problem. Don't worry. Okay. It will come into play.
1314. Go ahead for your question.
Sir, will you please explain the concept that the flat bulb can be used for a very long center descent, whereas V bulb is limited to 1 meter only. Why is that?
Yes. So your question is, what would be the specific applications of the flat belt and the V belt? Yes, absolutely correct. Flat belt
related to,
so it relates to the application that you are talking about. Okay, usually you have a flat drum, you know, and you will always prefer to have a flat belt on top of that. But let's say you have a groove, right, on the drum also.
Yes.
Then we are going to use the V belt, right? So V belt is basically put in a groove. So drum will have to have a groove, okay? Or the rotating system has some threads or grooves. There we are putting the V belt. So there will be additional force that is coming from those, you know, thread or groove. Okay.
Okay. The next question is, if I use a V belt in a flat pulley, what will be the reaction?
No, there will be no reaction because there is no nothing there. No. So in a flat pulley, so it is basically a 3D visualization. You have a flat pulley and I have this belt. Now if the flat, if there is nothing on these sides, right, of the pulley, okay, then there I am not getting any force from that side. Okay, so if the V belt is used in a flat pulley, it makes the same thing. We are going to solve the same problem, T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta. So problem will remain same. Okay?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
1330, go ahead for your question.
My question is, how to solve questions in which anything about the motion of the body is unknown? When we do not know whether body is impending, having an impending motion or not at all, or is moving on the on the other surface, whether anything about the motion is unknown. How to solve questions on that?
No, how can that be? You are applying the load, right? See, your question is, actually I have to restate the, rephrase the question. So your question would be, I am applying a load on a body. How do I determine that whether body is under static or under dynamic condition, right? In a friction problem. See, remember, friction force is a barrier. It's a barrier, right? You are trying to break that barrier. Okay, so you keep, think of it, I have a, you know, a block. Let's say I have a block on an inclined, okay? So I am trying to apply, so first I start applying the load, small load I am applying, right? At some point of time, you know, when the load is small, equilibrium will be maintained. That means you can actually use the Newton's first law that resultant force equals to zero, right? Remember, friction force is also, you know, if you plot that, that was done yesterday itself, right? So you are going to also gradually, you know, friction force is also increasing. But friction force has a limit, that is mu s multiplied by n, right? So as soon as your actual force that exceeds that mu s n, then the body is in imbalance condition, okay? So you have broken the barrier of the friction. So friction barrier is always mu s times n. Remember, that is based on the concept of point friction. Now when we say it's a dynamic, that means you have broken the barrier. Now we don't know, you know, body is under some acceleration or deceleration depending on the problem, then you have to use the dynamic equation, force equals to mass times acceleration, or force equals to, or moment equals to I times alpha. Okay, so to decide whether it is under static or dynamic, right, it is given by the whether the resultant force on the body is zero or non-zero. Okay, if the resultant force is non-zero, then of course it is dynamic. That's all, simple.
Sir, we have one more question.
Yes.
Sir, why we to take angle of contact in radians?
Why do? Because that's a mathematical problem, na? You are saying your question is why beta is taken in the radian. Because you are e to the power mu s beta, na? Beta has to be expressed in radian. Otherwise, it does not make any sense, okay? It's a mathematical problem.
Sir, is there any difference between angle of contact and angle of lap, or it is the same thing?
What was that, angle of?
Contact and angle of lap.
I don't know. Personally, I won't be able to answer it, okay? I don't know which problem you are talking about, but that is not irrelevant, I think.
Sir, my question is, what is the role of kinetic friction in torque transmission?
See, it's of course important. See, why your question is, what is the role of kinetic friction in torque transmission? Think of simple way. Think of, you know, a thrust bearing, end bearing problem, right? If we have an end bearing, let's say, you are applying a thrust, but I also need a couple, right? If it is rotating body, I need a couple. Okay. So, what is happening is that we have resistance from the end, right, that is coming through the kinetic coefficient of friction, because resistance to that. You think of disc brake problem. I just gave an example, disc brake. In the disc brake, right, that brake problem, it is under the motion, right. So, ultimately it is determined that what is the kinetic coefficient between the belt and the disc that will able to either decelerate the body, right. So, deceleration will depend on what is the kinetic coefficient of friction. But not only that, remember the contact angle here also plays an important role. What is the contact angle, that is also determined. And we will come to that problem, the question that you are asking, that kinetic coefficient of friction, if there is an actual slip between the belt and the drum, right, then how that torque is actually changing. Okay. So, it helps the changing the torque, definitely, depending on the coefficient of kinetic friction we have.
Sir, another question is, which types of precautions should be in mind before designing the like flat belt or V-belt?
When you are designing a belt, let us say, the two things are very important coming into play. Of course, as we have seen here, one is the coefficient of friction, and that was your in fact earlier question. Okay, kinetic coefficient of friction. So, that one thing. Another is definitely it is determined by the contact angle. Okay. So, these are the two aspects that we should look at when we are looking at the force. I am not getting into the other part of it. So, if your question is related to more of a design, then I am not answering to that, but more or less if it is related to force, right, these are the two things controlling the force. Okay, a transmission of torque, if you say like that, then these are the two things basically controlling. Okay.
1305, go ahead.
My question is, the problem which you have just solved on belt friction, there you have taken that wrap round and three wrap round and two wrap round, the angle of lap you have taken 6 pi and 4 pi. Can you elaborate separately by drawing that particular free body diagram? And can you justify how it has come 6 pi and 4 pi?
Yes. So, the question that we have received from 1305, that contact angle that we are saying, one is wrapped around 2 times, another is wrapped around 3 times. So, if I have a 2 wrap, can I simply explain it? I do not have. See, one, let us say one time. Let us say one time wrap, then what that should be? If it is a one time wrap, that means, let me draw it here, okay. So, what does that mean? That's it. That's a one wrap. So you go. Yeah, that is 2 pi, right? No. One wrap will be 2 pi. One wrap means we are going to make full revolution. Right? Okay, so that means that's it. Okay, so that's one wrap. So I go like this and then come back like this. Okay, then two wrap would this one actually. Okay, so you go around, then one more, then another. Okay, so two full revolution. Right? Remember, look at the problem there, you will see that one going like this and then exiting like that. right? So that makes it one wrap. If you have two wrap, then you have to wrap it around two times, okay? So just make two full circles, that's all, okay? So one full wrap will be 2 pi, 2 wrap will be 4 pi, and 3 wrap will be 6 pi.
Sir, what happens if I change the geometry from circular to rectangular?
Your question is you want to change it from circular to rectangular, but why? Why do you have that question in mind?
If I take the rectangular material, rectangular geometrical shape.
Nothing will happen, it's just going to get more complex because now you are going to see that you have three sides. Your question is if I have a rectangular segment, let's say not proper rectangular, you have some kind of, you know, fillet shape here, okay? So now you have a belt. Now it just you see that what is happening, as I said, friction is always going to gets complicated because now you have to look at this part, that part and this part. Three parts has to be separated and look into a different manner and problem gets more complicated, okay? Because remember what we have done in case of a flat belt on a drum. Right, we have always considered this small segment, okay, and we
try to establish the
and force was really delta F equals to mu delta N, right. So, we have again applied the concept of simple friction to go to the complex friction. We had to integrate, in this case it is even more complex, but remember this you will not see any physical problems. A physical problem will always try to address a nice circular, you know, drum or a pulley. Again, it will be determined by the free body diagrams and how you take into account.
Can you explain it again, why angle of contact taken in radian?
Angles are measured in radian. You have log value, log T2 by T1 equals to mu s beta. That is going back to simple math class. You have log of T2 by T1 equals to mu s beta, right? Now you are saying T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta. So therefore, beta should be measured in radian, okay?
1293, go ahead.
Why you are not considered the centrifugal tension in the flat belt and V belt?
Your question was why the centrifugal force was ignored. I did give that answer when I was discussing two ways. One is the center, the mass of the belt could be small, that is one thing. Second one was the answer could be the rotational speed is not that great, or in other words, the belt will not detach from the drum or the pulley, okay? We can just think of that way. If the rotation speed is very high, then we may have to incorporate that.
Sir, one more question, sir. Sir, in the V belt, there are another term is cosec beta is coming.
I
someone book are given cosec beta.
Yes, 1 over sin alpha, that is what it is, okay? 1 over sin alpha, that term, I tried to explain that before also.
No sir, I am asking to you that alpha for the lab angle, right? And beta for the V angle.
That is what it is, that's what I am saying. So you have e to the power mu s beta, so beta is the contact angle, okay, lap angle, right? And then there is another term which is sin alpha by 2, I think, 1 over sin alpha by 2, that comes from the V belt, that is from the cross sectional direction that is coming into play, okay? So there are two terms, okay, that is coming into play. Yes, we will now start little bit more, you know, getting into problem, especially if, you know, we should try to look at belt drives type of problem, how to, you know, look at belt drives. Okay, now this is another interesting problem we are going to study that involves both static coefficient of friction and kinetic coefficient of friction, okay? So now how this is happening, See, a cable passes around 3 2-inch radius pulleys and support 2 blocks as shown. So, in this problem, there are 3 pulleys. Remember, 2 of the pulleys, D and E, are locked to prevent the rotation. Okay? While the third pulley is rotated slowly at a constant speed. Just pay attention to this, that they are rotated at a very, you know, this third pulley C is rotating at a constant speed. So, we know the coefficient of friction between the cable and the pulleys. Determine the largest weight which can be raised if pulley C is rotated clockwise. That means, we are interested in finding out the largest weight that can be raised when this pulley is rotated very slowly clockwise. Again, this is rotating at a constant speed. Therefore, remember the belt and the pulley, they are intact. So, belt is also have the same angular rotation as that of the pulley. Okay. Now, in this here, belt is actually constantly slipping over these 2 pulleys. So, the problem involves, therefore, we can clearly see the two determine the largest weight that is possible to raise. We need to invoke the impending motion condition at C, right. So, for the impending motion, you can clearly see the largest weight that is possible will be based on when this belt will try to actually slip over the C. So, when the belt is trying to actually slip, okay, just about to slip over this pulley, then we will say that impending motion is reached and therefore, I will be able to obtain my largest weight that can be lifted up. Now, again, it will involve drawing the free body diagrams of each and every pulley. Remember, there is a kinetic coefficient of friction is coming into play. In drum D and drum E should have the kinetic coefficient of friction because the belt is constantly slipping over this pulleys. So, ultimately you see that to decide this problem, we first make sure that where the impending slip has to prevail because it relates to the largest weight, see the largest load that is possible. If we ask always this kind of question, then impending slip logic automatically comes into play. The other drum, the belt is constantly slipping, right. So, no problem here, we can simply use the kinetic coefficient of friction in these problems. So, now we have to really look at the free bodies, especially we will be concerned with the belts. So, you can see the tension on the belt side, we have to be careful that how the tensions are chosen, which side will be greater and which side would be lower. One more thing to understand, the contact angle, that is very important. So, the contact angle that we can find from the geometry of the problem. So, first we decide on the contact angle and we express that in terms of radian again. So, all the contact angles are shown here. Now, remember the C is rotated clockwise as I said. Therefore, which side the tension would be higher in this case? If it is rotated clockwise and if I try to look at the free body diagram of the drum itself, how the torque has to be transmitted, see you are applying a torque which is not given actually. A torque is applied clockwise. To balance that, this side of the tension has to be greater than the other side of the tension. So, WA must be greater than this side. So, tension in this side has to be greater on the right hand side. So, therefore, now this is becoming T2 and this is becoming T1. So, we say that WA is now T2 and T2 itself becomes T1. Okay. So, this is the higher tension side, this is the lower tension side, and it is very easy to understand also because I am rotating it clockwise, and to balance that torque, ultimately it has to be balanced by the opposite torque that is given. So, WA minus T2 multiplied by R, that will try to balance that torque. Okay. Similarly, so when I express this relationship, then I go to the next one. The next one will be, now we decide which side the tension would be higher. Now, remember the belt is constantly slipping over the pulley. So, the slip direction is already defined. Slip direction in this drum D and drum E is already defined. Therefore, I know the resistance direction. Resistance friction will always be opposing the motion. So, friction force direction is already known. If I know the friction force direction, which will be clockwise in this case, therefore, this side tension on the right hand side tension will be higher than the left hand side tension. So, now you see in the formula, I have to say that T1 is actually higher than T2, and I have done that based on the fact that which direction the belt is slipping. There is an actual slip between the belt and the drum. Remember, drum is fixed, belt is constantly slipping at a very slow speed. So, therefore, I am going to use T1 by T2 equals to e to the power mu k beta. So, I put that this is another expression, and the last expression, as we can see here, that again the same logic will be applied. This side tension will be greater than this side tension because there is a slip here, right? And frictional resistance is coming on the other direction, counterclockwise in this case, right? So, this tension will be greater than this center. So, I use this formula, 16 by T1. So, 16 by T1 should be equals to e to the power mu k beta I. Therefore, now what I have, I can now solve these three equations, right, to get a relationship between ultimate objective is to find out the WA, which can be achieved by the similar process we have done. So, the value of WA, the largest weight that can be raised is 11 pounds. Okay. So, now this problem involves using both static coefficient of friction as well as kinetic coefficient of friction. Remember, problem can come in variety of ways, but here again we are trying to study from the point of view of equilibrium, and we are trying to invoke the friction law as required. So, here we have a constant velocity problem. Constant velocity means a couple is applied, right? And therefore, we are trying to see when this slip is trying to, when this belt is simply trying to slip, what is that condition? That will be my impending slip condition, right? Then we looked at also when slip is actually happening. That is, there is relative slip between the belt and the pulley.